People often ask me, which is the best crafting technique? And the answer is, it depends. There are many different crafting techniques to choose from. If you check my channel, you will find videos covering each one of these crafting techniques in minute detail. So, when it's time to craft, which one should you choose? The season of the year is one of the most important factors that influence my choice of technique. The second factor is the age and diameter of the rootstock I am going to use. The third factor is the type of scion wood I have available. These factors will narrow down the choice of crafting technique to just one or two that are best suited for the job. If one of these techniques has the best rate of success, I end up choosing that one. Grafting in late winter or early spring means that the rootstocks are waking up with the warmer temperatures. The sap starts to flow, and this helps with graft healing and improves the percentage of graft success. In the summer, on some fruit types, the graft flow can be excessive and has to be drained, or it will drown the graft, causing it to fail. Scion wood is often stored in the fridge. As scions were cut in advance while the trees were dormant and are waiting for the best grafting conditions to arrive. When the buds in the rootstocks start to swell up, it means that the rootstock is waking up, and so it's a good time to start grafting. When I use young rootstocks to graft, they are usually pencil thick in diameter. If I have equal diameter scion wood, I will probably use the whip and tongue grafting technique, as it guarantees a solid union and a high percentage of success. But that is rarely the case. Scion wood of new and interesting varieties is usually scarce, and we can rarely choose what we get when trading or buying scions. When presented with young rootstocks and scion wood of different diameters, my go-to grafting technique is the modified cleft graft. It works in a wide range of different fruit types, has a very high percentage of success, provides a good enough union, and it's easier to execute than the whip and tongue. But above all those reasons, this grafting technique is excellent when you need to join rootstocks and scions of different diameter. That's why I prefer to use it. To use the modified cleft graft technique, you have to make two cuts in the rootstock. The first cut removes the top of the rootstock and leaves a flat surface. Make sure you use a sharp pruning shear to make a clean cut. The second cut is vertical to open a slot to insert the scion. As the scion is usually of a smaller diameter, the vertical cut on the rootstock should be near an edge where the rootstock diameter is smaller. If the rootstock has an oval shape, choose the best place to cut according to the scion wood diameter. Be sure to use the proper technique when making the vertical cut. Take your time and gently slide or rock the knife down, making a straight cut 1 or 2 inches long. Use the supporting hand to serve as an anchor, effectively limiting the length of the cut. Having this anchor point will avoid losing control of the knife, causing a failed cut, and also prevents injuries. The rootstock cut should be just long enough to accommodate the cut in the scion. Choose a straight piece of scion wood with 1 or 2 healthy buds. Make a bevel cut below the last bud. Finish the scion with a 45 degree small back cut. Although the back of the scion won't participate in the graft union, this small back cut is important, as it allows for a tight fit when adjusting the scion, and it's one of the first areas to establish cambium contact between the rootstock and the scion. Adjust the scion firmly in place, making sure the bevel cut is slightly above the top of the rootstock. Don't worry if the cuts don't perfectly match. In most cases, the scion is not wide enough to cover all the length of the horizontal cut in the rootstock. Just place it near one of the rootstock edges, so the cambium layers contact or cross at that edge. Placing the scion at a slight angle will make sure that the cambium lines will cross at some point. The growth of the new tissues and the success of the graft are guaranteed with this single cambium contact point and the contact point at the bottom. When tying the graft, make sure the scion stays roughly in the same position. Start at the top and make your way down, adjusting firmly. This extra pressure will make sure that the rootstock and scion tissues make good contact with each other, even if the cuts are not perfectly straight. I prefer to secure the graft with a self-vulcanizing tape, since it has enough strength to promote a good union between the scion and the rootstock. It also molds itself perfectly to the graft area, protecting the graft from rainwater damage, so there is no need to use pruning paste. When the graft will be exposed to the elements, you can cover the scion with a thin layer of parafilm. An alternative, when the graft will also be exposed to direct sunlight, is protecting it with a padded envelope. This will give the graft the best chances of healing without weather interference and damage that can cause failure. The envelope is usually removed after 3 or 4 weeks, since by then the buds should start growing. Start checking the graft after 3 or 4 weeks. I usually cut small openings in the envelope to check for bud growth. If I see signs of green growth, I will remove the envelope so the new leaves can start using the sun. Be sure to remove all new rootstock growth below the graft point. If left unchecked, it will use all the sap, causing graft failure. When using established rootstocks, the graft can grow very quickly. The young graft union will not be able to support the weight of the new growth, especially with the added pressure of strong winds. It's always a good idea to prune excessive new growth. I also like to tie a stake to the rootstock that will help support the weight until the graft union is strong enough to do it on its own. The modified cleft graft has a very high percentage of success across multiple fruit types. Success percentages above 80% are usually the norm with this type of graft if you follow my recommendations. In my last batch of kiwi grafts, only 2 grafts failed in a total of 20, and in one of them the quality of the scion was not ideal to start with. The modified cleft graft is not difficult to execute. Has a great level of adaptability, since it allows adjustment to different diameter rootstocks and scions. It works with a wide range of different types of fruit trees. Has a very high percentage of success. It provides a clean and strong union after the first year. So, in conclusion, this grafting technique is highly recommended. These videos require lots of time and effort to make. Show me your appreciation by liking the video and leaving a comment. Share the video, and if you haven't already, consider subscribing the channel to help me make more videos. Thanks for watching.